here, and welcome back to Biology. We're about to delve into our unit on evolution, and it starts with a big voyage. Have you ever dreamed of traveling the world, going places no one has ever gone before, seeing things no one else has ever seen? At least no one that you know. Do you think a voyage like this could change the course of your life? This is exactly what happened to a young English naturalist in 1831. Today, we're going to follow the famous voyage of Charles Darwin on the HMS Beagle as he travels the world in the 1830s. The things he sees on this voyage will alter the course of his life and the course of modern biology. Before we head out on his ship, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to describe the common themes Darwin encountered when making his observations on the HMS Beagle, and explain how these observations led him to question the commonly accepted theory that life on Earth was static. Charles Darwin was born to a wealthy British family in 1809. His father was a doctor, and he was expected to follow in his footsteps. However, even before being sent to medical school in 1825, Charles had proved he was far more interested in collecting bugs and plants than learning human anatomy. So, not surprisingly, he didn't stay in medical school for long, but while he was there, he met John Edmonstone, a former slave from Guyana, who taught him the art of taxidermy. It was a skill that would serve him well in a few years. He left medical school and went to Cambridge, studying for the priesthood. Many of his fellow students and professors were committed to studying the plants and animals of the natural world, and Darwin's innate curiosity found a home here. Almost immediately after graduation, he was offered a position as a naturalist aboard a 2-year voyage on the HMS Beagle. The voyage's main purpose was to explore much of the world to gather map-making information, but the captain wanted a scientist along as well to document what they found. It was an unpaid position, away from home for a long time, and had already been turned down by many other more renowned scientists. But it was the perfect opportunity for Darwin. He later called it the most important event of his life, and said that it determined his whole career. On December 27, 1831, the HMS Beagle set sail from Plymouth Sound. The voyage would take them around the world through much of the southern hemisphere. One of the first stops was supposed to be the Canary Islands at Tenerife. Unfortunately, the trip started out with disappointment, as they were not able to go ashore due to quarantine restrictions from a cholera outbreak in England. Instead, they made an unplanned stop in the Cape Verde Islands. Darwin was still sulking a bit at having missed Tenerife and went ashore at Cape Verde with rather low expectations. However, he was immediately struck by the complexity of the geologic landforms he saw. Huge volcanic rock formations and steep, rocky shorelines. There were fossils at every turn, including marine fossils found in the mountains high above the sea. How could the remains of fish and sea creatures end up on top of a mountain? He began to suspect that the geologist, Charles Lyell, was right about his theory that the Earth was very old, known as deep time, and that it had gone through many changes along the way. Ground that once made up the bottom of the ocean now sat high above the land after being risen by geologic forces. He also found that many of the fossils resembled creatures living in the area now, but they had obvious differences too. This would be a recurring theme of his findings along the trip, and gave him much to think about. From Cape Verde, the HMS Beagle traveled onward to the coast of South America. The Brazilian rainforests were described by an awestruck Darwin as a chaos of delight. He found wasps that laid eggs inside live caterpillars so that the larvae could eat the caterpillar alive from the inside when they hatched, as well as beetles, worms, and spiders in all shapes, sizes, and colors imaginable. Fossils of huge, long-extinct animals dotted the landscape and painted a picture of a fantastic, storied past. While on an exploration in Patagonia, Darwin's local guides often hunted rhea for food, which were large, flightless birds. They told stories of a related animal called the lesser rhea. Darwin was determined to find one to add to his growing collection of specimens. He did find one. A few weeks later, after sailing down the coast, as the crew was sitting down to dinner, he noticed that the dinner they were happily eating wasn't the usual rhea. It was the mystery species Darwin had been after. Luckily, he was able to piece together enough of the bones of the animal from the scraps to make a complete model to send home. Since the beginning of the voyage, Darwin had been sending back to England the taxidermied specimens he'd caught and stuffed, and his collection at home had now grown substantially. He knew that his colleagues would not believe the incredible diversity of life he was finding unless he could show them proof, and the specimens would prove invaluable after he returned and worked to complete his study of all that he had seen on the voyage. But the trip wasn't always smooth sailing. Darwin dealt with debilitating bouts of seasickness and experienced the destructive forces of earthquakes and volcanoes, which left him unsettled and shaken. Besides being distraught by the destruction they caused, he also began to doubt the commonly held ideology that the Earth itself was static and unchanging. It seemed everywhere he looked, there was upheaval and natural chaos. Even more horrific for Darwin was his first up-close encounter with the slave trade. Observations of the torture that enslaved people endured at slave markets in the ports visited by the HMS Beagle caused Darwin to doubt another sacredly held tenet of his time, that humans were fundamentally different from animals and morally superior. One of the most famous stops of the voyage was at the Galapagos Islands, off the western coast of South America. But it certainly didn't start out with any fanfare. In fact, by this point in the voyage, Darwin was tired and homesick. They had already been gone for 4 years, which was twice as long as they had planned, and they were still nowhere near home. It didn't help that Darwin was wholly unimpressed with the islands at first. It was hot, humid, and had a rather unpleasant smell. He described the many iguanas that populated the shoreline as hideous creatures. But it was here that Darwin would make some of his greatest discoveries. In the Galapagos, he would find many species that didn't exist anywhere else in the world, and some were even specific to only one of the islands. For example, he was assured by the governor that one could tell exactly which island a giant tortoise came from just by the shape of its shell. Every island had its own species of giant tortoise. Clearly, the tortoises on all of the islands were very much related, but why would a slightly different species exist on each one? Another animal that fascinated Darwin here was the finch. Similar to the tortoises, there seemed to be a different variety of finch on each island. He noted that they were definitely very similar to the finches found on the mainland of South America, but different enough to clearly be their own species. And being the keen observer that he was, he made a groundbreaking observation about how they were different. The beak shape of the finches differed dramatically from island to island, as did their primary food source. It seemed suspiciously convenient to Darwin that the shape of the finches' beaks were perfectly adapted to food that was available to them. On islands where hard seeds were readily available, the finches had strong, crushing beaks to crack them open. On islands with nectar buried deep inside flowers, the finches had long, probing beaks to draw it out. Darwin's observations here left him with more questions to ponder. The species he saw seemed to be related to what he had seen before, but also distinctly different. And their differences did not appear to be random, but rather gave the animals specific adaptations that helped them survive in their environment. As he reviewed his notes and the specimens he had brought back from the Galapagos, a revolutionary idea began to form in his head. Could they all have originated from the same species, but have begun to diverge as they were isolated on different islands and needed to adapt to different environments? The HMS Beagle continued around the Southern Hemisphere, stopping in Sydney, Australia. It was here that Darwin saw his first marsupials. After watching the kangaroos and platypus, he was struck by the similarity of their niche and ecosystem to ones he had observed elsewhere. Yet the animals here were dramatically different and dealt with the same challenges in very different ways. They seemed to have more in common with other animals that lived nearby than they did with animals that lived in a similar environment on the other side of the world. The crew made a few other stops in Mauritius and Cape Town. Despite being drawn in by the natural beauty of the landscape and warmed by the hospitality of the locals, they were very homesick now and didn't stay long. The ship finally arrived back in England in October of 1836, nearly 5 years after departing. Darwin had left England as a fresh Cambridge graduate and hobbyist in the natural sciences. However, thanks to the hundreds of samples and notes that he had been sending back during the voyage, he returned as a well-known and respected professional naturalist. His observations had already piqued the interest of many in the scientific community, and they were eager for more. But it would take many years for Darwin to make sense of all that he had seen, and poring over his notes and specimens would occupy much of his time during his long and productive career as a scientist. He kept noticing common themes creeping up. Species found in neighboring regions often showed many similarities to one another, and were often very different from species in further regions of the world, even when the environments were very similar. They also seemed curiously adapted to their specific situation. He saw similar trends in the fossils he sent back. They appeared to be related to the animals currently living in the area, but showed signs of adaptations to a different time as well. A single thought kept nagging at him. Was it possible that these species were related to each other and had originally come from a common ancestor? This explanation went against all that he had been taught, but would fit exactly with all that he had observed. Geographically close populations would be expected to have more in common, as they would have diverged from a common ancestor more recently than populations separated by great distances. He kept these thoughts to himself for many years as he continued studying and consulting with colleagues. Instead of publishing his biggest idea, he wrote many papers on less controversial topics relating to geology and reef formation. He was not a confrontationalist by nature and had no desire to stir up controversy with what he was sure would be considered heresy. He finally did publish his ideas in 1859 with his groundbreaking book, On the Origin of Species, followed later by Descent of Man. Other scientists were beginning to come to these same conclusions after making similar observations in different parts of the world. Darwin finally overcame his fear of publishing simply so that someone else wouldn't beat him to it. These works would spark a revolution and make Darwin one of the most well-known scientists in history. As we went through the lesson today, we followed Darwin's voyage around the world and looked at the common themes his observations showed. What puzzled Darwin for years was the explanation of a mechanism by which species could change in order to adapt to their environment. Over the course of the 2 decades between returning from his voyage and writing his book, he managed to solve his own puzzle. He called the mechanism natural selection. Next time, we'll take a look at natural selection in detail to see how it explains Darwin's findings. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.